Random House Audio presents The Honored Dead, a story of friendship, murder, and the search for truth in the Arab world, by Joseph Braude. Read for you by Benson, Simmonds. The realist in murder writes of a world in which gangsters can rule nations and almost rule cities. Raymond Chandler. Prologue. Muhammad Bari eased out of his bedroom and opened the creaking front door just enough to make his way outside. His wife needed her sleep. She had to get up for work in an hour. Usually Bari's best friend would be waiting for him in the alleyway, and they would walk together to a nearby mosque for the dawn prayer. This morning, the alleyway was empty. Bari didn't worry. Sometimes his friend slept in until sunrise. It was December in Casablanca, Morocco's sprawling economic capital on the Atlantic coast of North Africa. An ocean mist chilled the lingering darkness. Bari's teeth chattered as he took off his shoes outside the mosque and placed them in an empty cubbyhole. He performed his ritual ablutions in the washroom and proceeded barefoot into the sanctuary, warm with body heat. Several hundred people had already lined up on the floor in long rows facing east. The sanctuary's warmth was welcome, but the dawn prayer lasted only 10 minutes. Ordinarily, Bari and his friend would repair from the mosque to a nearby cafe. If one or both of them had missed the dawn prayer, they would find each other inside. They would sit and talk for hours while people with jobs hurried in and out. This morning, Bari arrived alone, drank his coffee alone, and read the newspapers alone, and watched Al Jazeera alone, and worried about where his friend could be now. The place where he sleeps does not belong to him, he thought. He has to evacuate early so that the men who control the facility do not catch him. Could he have overslept? How could he possibly risk sleeping past sunrise? Bari finally felt driven from his familiar cafe chair to find out what was going on with his friend, why he had left Bari alone on this morning. He knew where to go. He knew the place well. The enormous warehouse is enclosed by a spiked metal wall that someone painted red a long time ago. At one end, the wall abuts a field of gravel and dirt, bisected by the same train track that slices the city in half. People gather there at night to lie around and get drunk. Nobody ventures over that wall. Nobody is supposed to go inside except the people who work there. Silence ordinarily surrounded the place, but not this morning. When Bari reached the spiked front gate, it was surrounded by state security. A dozen uniformed police minded a perimeter of yellow ribbon. Auxiliary forces troops in green fatigue stood guard by the entrance. Plainclothes detectives paced in and out.
Who are you? What do you want?
One of them barked. I'm looking for a friend of mine, Bari replied. The detective locked in on Bari's eyes. He grabbed him by the forearm and pulled him in past the gate to a raucous crowd of cops who were bending down and peering over and putting down markers and taking pictures and arguing with one another. There was a rusty smell in the air.
That was a friend of yours?
The detective demanded, pointing. Bari turned his head toward the stone steps leading up to the guards' quarters, where his friend always slept. What he saw, he did not understand at first. The steps were drenched in red. There was a large thing lying on top of them. It had a blood-soaked beard, a couple of teeth, and clothes on. There was a head, but it was mutilated into a different shape. Bari began to feel a heat rising in his head and throat. His temple started pulsating. Now the rest of his body was in on it. He couldn't breathe. He lost his balance. The detective steadied him by the forearm, which was still clasped tight in his muscular hand. The lieutenant who questioned Bari over the next 3 days wore jeans and a charcoal gray blazer. Lieutenant Jabri was genteel, more relaxed than the men at the warehouse, perhaps a little weary of his work. He rarely raised his voice. He never insulted Bari or the other detainee, and he phrased his questions thoughtfully. Rather than refer to the murder victim by name, for example, he always called him al-marhum, Arabic for he who has been granted mercy. On the third day, he went through the same battery of questions he had asked the day before and the day before that. You're sure al-marhum was never in any trouble? the lieutenant asked.
Never, Barry said.
How would you describe his character?
Barry combed his scraggly salt and pepper beard with his fingernails and shaped it with his knuckles.
I said yesterday he had a good reputation all over the neighborhood and he went to pray in the mosque every morning.
The detainee who sat next to Barry in the lieutenant's office nodded vigorously.
The last time you saw him?
The night before you found him, Barry replied. It was Sharif the book peddler and me, and we had a bowl of harira with him.
Was al-Marhum preoccupied, agitated?
No, he was comfortable, and maybe a little cheerful. He said he was going to do some small deal, and he thought it was going to come through.
The lieutenant had been seated at his desk. Now he abruptly stood up and looked down at Barry, who had to crane his neck to meet the lieutenant's eyes.
How long did al-Marhum sleep in that place? How long did he sleep there?
Barry twitched.
The truth. 5 years.
5 years, Jabri repeated. Did you ever visit him inside?
Sometimes, Barry replied.
A lot or a little?
Not often. Very rarely.
That wasn't true. Did he have other visitors there? Was it common for him to bring people in there?
Barry could feel his own pulse. The lieutenant must notice the blood rushing to my face, he thought.
Yes, I do remember that sometimes I would come by and knock and he would say he had people inside and I should come back later.
The lieutenant moved slowly back to the chair behind his desk, fixing his eyes on the other detainee. The man who sat next to Barry, a man named Attar, was visibly frightened, increasingly so each day. The police had let Barry go around 7 o'clock the night before with instructions to come back the following morning, but they had held on to Attar God knows how late. When Barry returned, he found Attar alone in the office waiting for the lieutenant to arrive. He was slumped over in his chair, asleep. Barry tapped him on the shoulder, and Attar convulsed. He cried,
"There is no power or strength except in God!"
and looked frantically in several directions before setting his rose-pink eyes on Barry.
"Oh, I'm so sorry," he said. "I'm so sorry."
The stars had come out on the third day of questioning by the time a distant tumult from the ground floor of the precinct drew louder and nearer, banging up the staircase on squeaky, wet boots. There was yelling and a nasal, wordless plea. Into the room walked four detectives, all sweaty, and a young man between them in handcuffs. He limped and wore a bandage stained with blood around his left wrist. 8 hands were on his body. Barry had a son his age.
"What I want to know is," one of the detectives began to say.
The lieutenant motioned him to stop talking.
"Brothers," the lieutenant said, "we would like to ask whether either of you has seen this young man before."
He looked at Attar, who shook his head.
"Brother Muhammad Bari?" "I have never seen him before in my life, and he must not be from our area because I know I would have seen him at least once or twice if he were from here,"
Bari declared. Overdoing it a bit, he realized. The lieutenant snapped his fingers, and an old typist from across the hall showed up with paper. Barry and Attar were made to sign affidavits to the effect that the young man was a stranger to them.
"My brothers," the lieutenant said, "you are free to go."
Attar darted out of the room with barely a "God keep you." Barry didn't move at first. He looked at the boy in handcuffs for as long as his eyes would let him. This man's role in Bari's simple life began to dawn on him. Bari stood up and steadied himself, making a tentative approach toward the lieutenant. He took a deep breath.
"This is the man?" Bari asked.
The lieutenant nodded.
"Why did he? The important thing is that we have caught him, and he will confess."
Another deep breath.
"That's it?" Bari asked.
"Brother Muhammad," the lieutenant said, "try to move on."
Barry went to bed that night weeping and weeping at last. Because he had been detained, he had missed the funeral. So had Attar. In his tears, Barry could picture it, having lent a hand in the burial of indigent neighbors before. From the great city morgue off the interstate, the body would be thrown into a rickety red and white ambulance and driven 250 yards to the expansive burial grounds of mercy.
down a long, flowery lane where amputees and orphans confer blessings in exchange for charity, the dark sack would reach its pit. There are few family plots in Casablanca. Lanes fill up with bodies in the order in which they are received. A cleric whom the victim had never met would go through Salat al-Janaza, a special prayer for funerals. The grave would be marked by a long number. Bari lay awake all night. When he ran out of tears, he started asking questions of his own. Chapter 1. It's 9:30 p.m. in Casablanca, and the Al Jazeera sports channel blares off a corner wall to a rapt, all-male crowd in the coffeehouse near precinct headquarters. A game is on. The score is tied with seconds to go, and the promise of victory for Wydad, a local soccer team, looms like a ticking bomb. A thick cloud of cigarette smoke and sweat chokes the room. Most of the viewers are too engrossed to say a word, but four plainclothes police, hunched around one table sipping mint tea, have been trashing the rival Syrian team in Morocco's distinctive dialect of Arabic.
"Donkeys," they call out, hissing. "Pigs, go home to your sty."
My own clear view of the TV screen is obstructed suddenly by an explosion of frenzied men jumping, smacking, kicking, and hugging amid spontaneous cries of "Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar." Every table becomes a war drum, every ashtray a rattling tambourine. One man grabs hold of a table between his arms and crashes it repeatedly against the linoleum floor. A Coke bottle smashes. The acrid cloud over our head seems to yield a few drops of rain, and in the noise of shouting and cavorting, I catch a glimpse of the instant replay. Wydad just pulled off an upset victory, thanks to a long-shot goal by native son Muhammad Falla. The athlete grew up in a shantytown family from the slums a few blocks east. All four cops join the celebration, banging tables with the rowdiest fans, until a shrill finger whistle from outdoors cuts above the shouting of the crowd. Alerted by the cue, the policemen stand tall, pushing their way clear of the room and out the front door with the universal swagger of their profession. I march straight out of the coffeehouse with them, as we are formally joined at the hip. Just outside, a young woman in a brown hooded robe is heaving a wordless plea into the wiry frame of Abd al-Qadir Marzouk, the cop's commanding officer. She squeezes both his wrists.
"You have to get him and lock him up tonight or the man will kill me," she says.
Marzouk pries free an arm and points an index finger at each of his pale gray eyes, a North African sign of devotion to a task. "You are my sister," he adds, though she is not. Three of his four men pile into the back cage of a white van marked National Security in blood red paint. The fourth takes the steering wheel, and Marzouk rides shotgun. With 2 days to go before the joyous Muslim festival of Eid al-Adha and the first big win for Casablanca's home team in 5 long weeks, police citywide are energized by God and country. And it is a wretched night for any wanted man to wind up captured by the Moroccan security services. I climb in with the back cage crew and hear a sound like wood chips cracking under my sneakers. The light goes on briefly, and I see what litters the grooved metal floor. Thousands of sunflower seed shells spat out by cops and their prey over months, maybe years of night raids into the city's teeming slums. The van swerves off the main road and I tumble onto a cold metal bench. "You almost missed," an officer says, punching me gently in the shoulder. We speed east into the darkening margins of the city. In the front seat, Marzouk cusses out an ex-wife over his mobile phone, something about their teenage daughter, until a different phone, the one informants dial him on, warbles the Moroccan national anthem out of his vest pocket, ending the chat with his ex.
"Yes!" he shouts into the informant line. "God keep you! Where?"
He nods his head and promises forceful action, with God as his witness. The band comes to a screeching halt and my benchmates tumble out the back. We emerge by the curb of a circular concrete embankment at an asphalt roundabout near the northeast tip of the city. A rooster crows in the distance. Livestock faintly moo and bleat. nestled among palm trees, a pair of...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.